Beloved, good morning and welcome. I'm Reverend Jamie Michaels. I'm pastor here at First and Summerfield United Methodist Church, and it is my joy to welcome you into the sanctuary this morning. Whether you are here in person or you're joining us online, welcome to you. It's a glorious day in the kingdom of God. God is coming to be with us and among us, and indeed God is here. With whatever you have brought to this moment, your heat and exhaustion, or your excitement for the summer, your tiredness, or your sorrow, God has come to meet you here exactly as you are, exactly as we are. Let's breathe in that confidence, right? In that trust that God is here within and among us. First in Summerfield is a reconciling community of the United Methodist Church, which means that no matter who you are, no matter where you are on your journey of faith, no matter whom you love, you are always welcome here. You're welcome whether you are in this space physically or whether you're with us virtually. And so our lay leader, Bob Hancock, I want to invite you to give us a welcome from our virtual world.
Good morning, First of Summerfield. It's hot, it's humid, but what do you want? It's July and summer. And supposedly, God may give one of his own fireworks display later on this afternoon and evening. Generally, a glorious day to be alive.
Amen. Praise God. Beloved, I invite you to rise in spirit or in body for our call to worship. My soul waits for God more than those who long for the morning's first light. God is faithful, steadfast, and full of mercy. So I will put my hope in God. God is full of forgiveness and overflowing with love. So I will put my hope in God. My soul waits for God more than those who long for the morning's first light. Let us praise the God who raises us from sorrow. Broken the one.
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories ever echoing, the triumphs of God's grace.
You may be seated. Please join me in a spirit of prayer as we join together in this unison prayer of confession printed in your bulletin. God, your sun rises on this world each new day, and yet how often we forget you. Surrounded by sorrow, we sometimes slip into despair. Remind us that through all manner of pain and sadness, you walk with us. Help us to know that our joy doesn't come from the world, but from you. Lift our heads from the hurt of this world and guide us towards hope in you. And now, beloved, in the silence, I invite you to lift your own personal confessions to God. Dear friends, God the Maker, Jesus the Healer, and the Spirit of Reconciliation are remaking this world in peace. You are forgiven and freed for love. We are forgiven and freed for love.
I invite you to stand as you're able for the reading of the gospel. Today's gospel reading comes from Mark chapter 5, verses 21 through 43. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered round him, and he was by the lake. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue named Jairus came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him. And a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, for she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately, her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately, aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talita kum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
We don't have any children in the sanctuary this morning, but in case anybody with us online has kids with them, or in case you're watching this later with kiddos, I want to tell you that, do you remember a couple of weeks ago we sang Happy Birthday to the church in here? Well, this week we celebrated another birthday in the life of the church, and that's the birthday of John Wesley, who was the founder of Methodism. His birthday is June 28th. And so I thought that in honor of John Wesley's birthday, we might talk about some things that were special about him or unique to him. It's fun, isn't it, when we celebrate a birthday, to think about how God made every single one of us, and how on your birthday, that's our opportunity to celebrate how special you are and the uniqueness that God made you in, right? So here are some things that you might not know about John Wesley. Did you know that he was a science buff, and specifically, he loved to learn about the human body? He wrote a medical textbook that was one of the best-selling books of its time. And some of his stuff is still used today, but I wouldn't recommend you go pick up this book because there are also things in it like, when you have a stomach ache, you should hold a puppy against your tummy. He also suggested that submersing yourself in ice baths or really cold water would cure just about any ailment you have. And he carried around sometimes in his pockets little pills made up of powdered toad, because he believed that this was a panacea, that this was something that would treat your ailments. So maybe not the kind of book that we would go and pick up today. But he was very interested in science. Another thing about John Wesley is that he coined the phrase, agree to disagree. Anybody ever heard somebody say that to them? Agree to disagree. John Wesley coined this because he was in a fight with George Whitefield all the time. George Whitefield was another preacher, and they were writing letters to each other all the time, just disagreeing about what the scriptures say. But John Wesley felt like it was so much more important to keep George Whitefield's friendship that he said, "We're gonna have to agree to disagree on this one. Your friendship is more important than me, than me being right, so I'm not gonna fight with you anymore." My last favorite fact about John Wesley is, you know that he rode his horse around a lot? He wanted to tell everybody about the good news of Jesus, and so he took his horse everywhere, right, so that he could go out into the communities that nobody else was talking to. He rode over 250,000 miles on horseback. I bet some of you have cars that have not gone that far, right? That's enough to circle the world. Somebody check me on this if my math is wrong. 10 times. That's how far John Wesley rode on his horse, so that he could tell everybody he came into contact with about the good news of God. So I want to know this morning, what's your favorite fact about yourself? What's something surprising about yourself that you think people in the church might not know, or that you might want to share with somebody else? Does anybody have one? I have one. I might have told you this before. I was a competitive gymnast, and I was, during 1 year, I was the handstand champion of North Carolina. Something you might not know. What makes you special? Anybody? Yeah, Kimmy. Kimmy can't snap her fingers. All right. Kimmy, you are so special and beloved and beautiful in the eyes of God. Anybody else? Oh, yeah, Jean. Go ahead and unmute yourself.
Okay. Yeah, I was living up in New Hampshire and met a woman who had been training in New York City to be a dancer, and she left New York City to come to the country. So I trained with her, and we performed around New Hampshire and Maine. We performed modern dance.
Wow. Oh, Jean, that's so special. Jean, God has made you beautiful and beloved, and you are so special in the eyes of God. Anybody else? Do we have one more special fact about somebody? Abby. Abby is a soup magician. She can make anything into a soup, and they are always delicious. Abby, you are so beloved and special and beautiful in the eyes of God. Well, let's, acknowledging that we are all special and acknowledging that we have just celebrated John Wesley's birthday, let's sing happy birthday to him. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, John Wesley. Happy birthday to you. Amen. Will you pray with me? God, through me or in spite of me, preach your word this morning. Amen. Following the attacks on September the 11th, Bruce Springsteen released an album called The Rising, and the title song on that album talks about the first responders who, wearing the cross of their calling, got up that morning and ran not away from the fire, but into the fire. Moving through the smoke and the destruction, he talks about how when he interviewed these people later, when he heard their stories, they didn't talk about destruction and death, although that's what surrounded them and that's what they saw. They talked about the rising. They talked about the indomitable human spirit. They talked about the way that people came together to support one another and help one another. This is a common theme, not just in songs, but in poetry and in stories. It's a common theme in news media, right? The idea that despite everything that is falling down around us, we might, in fact, rise. One of my favorite songwriters talks about this. He says, "Rise up, though the promise goes unspoken. Rise up when the joy comes to your eyes. Rise up, for your soul was never broken. Beloved, it is time for you to rise." Our own United Methodist hymn writer and musician Mark Miller writes a song about rising and resisting. He says, "We resist, we refuse to let hatred in. We rise up, we won't back down. We're in this till the end." In today's gospel story, we hear two tales of rising. One rising from an illness and one rising from death. Looking around our world today, it's not hard to see parallels between the hemorrhaging woman, Jairus' daughter, and people who exist in our world today? How many of us have not known someone who has spent long years talking to physicians, only to find no help in the end? How many of us have not seen others in our community or in our lives seemingly beaten down by systems that isolate and separate them from the world around them? How many of us have not seen images and heard stories of parents who have lost children far too young? To the scourge of gun violence, to war, to starvation. Our world is full of images and stories of people who have been beaten down, seemingly to never rise again. A few weeks ago, from this very spot, our friend Margaret invited us to consider what lessons Jesus may have learned from the woman at the well. You remember that story, right? Jesus was on the physical edge, the margin of where his ministry had been, right? And he stood in that place, and he met a woman who was from a community that he shouldn't have been engaging in, according to custom. She was there in the middle of the day, and some traditions say that this might mean that she had been scorned from her community. Margaret invited us to reconsider that and said maybe she had just been taking care of somebody in the morning. She didn't have time to come to the well in the morning. Maybe she had been busy at work and she couldn't come to the well in the morning. Regardless, Jesus encounters this woman and he has a change of heart because he first sends her away and then is taught something by her. Well, here we are in the Gospel of Mark, and Mark, who is usually scant on specifics, has so much to tell us in this story. Already in the Gospel of Mark, when we meet Jesus here in this crowded village, already in the story, Jesus has driven out unclean spirits. He's cured people with fevers and diseases. He's healed a leper. He's healed a man who was paralyzed. He's healed a man who had a withered hand. He even empowered his own disciples to heal and drive out demons in his name. And he stilled the very winds and storms that threatened to destroy the boat that he and his disciples were riding on. Jesus, in short, has been powerful in the Gospel of Mark. And despite the fact that in every place he's gone, he's told people to be quiet about the works that he's doing, people are hearing about it. Because everywhere he goes, the crowds are pressed in on him. So much so that he and his disciples have to make plans to make sure that he isn't overcome by the crowds. So given all of this, all of the evidence to Jesus of how powerful he is, why does he seem surprised when this woman touches his cloak, one in perhaps 100 people surrounding him, and receives his power? Why does he not promise Jairus that he's coming to resurrect his little girl? Why does he just say, have faith and be patient? Why, when he goes to heal this little girl, does he only allow Peter and James and John to follow him? I have so many questions. And often when I read a text and have so many questions, things like, what's the deal with these 12 years? Why has the woman been hemorrhaging for 12 years and the daughter is 12 years old, right? Things like, why does he call both of them daughter? Why does he say to one, daughter, arise, your faith has made you well, and to the other, daughter, get up and come back and join your community? When I have a lot of questions like this, I begin to wonder about the text. And one of the things I like to do is try to imagine myself in the scene of the text. And this week I began wondering if the hemorrhaging woman wasn't like that woman at the well, giving Jesus a much needed gift that day. I wonder if he didn't walk away more blessed and more healed than she did. I wonder if on that day, Jesus, seeing the demand for his healing, seeing the yearning of the people, seeing the depth of their suffering, I wonder if he hadn't begun to doubt himself. I wonder if he hadn't begun to doubt the limits of even God's power to work in him and through him to heal the people. I wonder if Jesus wasn't looking upon the scope and the magnitude of their task, looking at how many people were in God's world who needed help, and thinking to himself, how in the name of all that is holy am I going to accomplish this? If that were so, if that were the mind of Jesus on this day, if Jesus was feeling just a little bit overwhelmed, or maybe even just a little bit in over his head, I wonder how that would change the way we hear the story. Here's how I imagine it. Surrounded by the crowd, jostled and grabbed and touched and shoved and pushing his way through a sea of people, he stops in his tracks. He can feel a power active within and around him that's connecting him to someone. He knows that there is a healing happening, but unlike the times before, Jesus didn't initiate this. He didn't choose to come to someone's bedside and lay hands on them. He didn't ask them if they wanted to be healed. This happened without his intention. In fact, it happened without his even knowing it. And so, searching the throng with his eyes, he begins turning left and right, looking up and down over the heads of the people surrounding him, and he asks, "Who touched me?" It was a ludicrous question, of course, because there were dozens of people surrounding him. Everyone is touching him. And suddenly his eyes find hers. Caught in his gaze, she drops down to his feet, and she tells him everything. The whole truth, Scripture tells us. I wonder how long it took her to tell that whole truth. How long they stood there in the center of this congregation? How long does it take for her to tell him of those 12 long years? Of the incident that first led to her bleeding? Of the fear that she felt? Of the pain of her body? How long does it take her to tell him that she hasn't been able to talk to other people about this? That when she does, the people call her unclean. How long does it take Jesus to understand that for 12 years, no doctor has been able to tell her what's wrong with her? That she has spent everything that she had, not just her money, but her energy, her time, and her hope, trying to come to healing. How long does it take Jesus to understand and to feel her daily pain? Her isolation, her hopelessness that has led her to this desperate moment. Finally, her story comes to this morning, and she tells him that she had been hearing rumors about this man, this healer, who is doing things that nobody ever thought possible. He's touching people that nobody had come near in years. And even the other night, when there was that super rough storm on the Sea of Galilee, it cleared up so fast in ways that people hadn't seen. And there were rumors that it was him. And so this morning, she decided, I'm going to try again one more time. It reminds me of that quote by Maya Angelou. She says, "Have the courage to trust love one more time and always one more time." And she tells him, "When nothing else could help, your love lifted me." I wonder how long Jesus paused before he spoke. I imagine that by now he has knelt down to her level, or he has raised her up so they're looking eye to eye. I think something in this encounter has changed him. I imagine him looking right at her And rather than point to himself and the goodness of his healing or even the power of God, he points to her and says, "Your faith has made you well." Beloved, this scripture and others like it have been used in the past to tell people, if you just believed a little harder, if you just prayed a little more fervently, then God would heal you. But our text doesn't tell us anything about the faith of this woman as you and I understand faith, right? It doesn't tell us that she believed the right way. It doesn't tell us that she was a member of the synagogue. It doesn't tell us that she had performed all of the rituals to become clean again. It tells us that she came to Jesus. She came to him honestly with everything that she had and with the tiniest glimmer of hope that God could do something for her. That morning, despite everything she had been through, she arose and she faced the day one more time. I wonder if that encounter with this woman, watching the years of labor that she had been through, watching the emotional struggle she had been through and the physical pain she had been through, and the endurance to be there still through it all, I wonder if that didn't change Jesus. I wonder if that didn't give him the strength and the faith that he needed to be able to look to Jairus and say, "Have a little faith, friend." I wonder if he didn't carry the experience of this story with him even to the cross. For the courage to reach down deep and believe that God has something good for this world, even in the midst of the worst suffering, even in the midst of death. The truth of this story, beloved, the truth of our experience is that every time one of us rises, we help lift the others. Every story of resurrection, every story of reconnection, every time one of us is healed, we all come that much closer to healing. And so this day, I invite us to look back into our own lives, into the stories of those who have impacted us. Where are the places where God has worked something out of nothing? Where are the places where still, despite every suffering, despite every grief, despite every loss, you have seen one another stand up and be present? Sometimes it is not our job to get to healing. Sometimes it is not our job to get all the way to joy. Sometimes it is our job only to rise when our name is called and to be present, open to the joy and healing that God may have, be it now or 12 years from now or 100 years from now, to believe that healing is possible. Do we have the courage, friends, to lay down the things that trouble us, to lay them at the feet of Jesus and to say, "Do with this what you may"? I leave you today with these words from Maya Angelou. "You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may trod me in the very dirt, but still, like dust, I rise. Just like the moons and suns, with the certainty of tides, just like hope springing high, still I'll rise. Did you want to see me broken, bowed head and lowered eyes, shoulders falling down like teardrops, weakened by my soulful cries? You may shoot me with your words. You may cut me with your eyes. You may kill me with your hatefulness, but still, like air, I'll rise. Out of the huts of history's shame, I rise. Up from a past that's rooted in pain, I rise. I'm a black ocean, leaping and wide, welling and swelling, I bear in the tide. Leaving behind nights of terror and fear, I rise. Into a daybreak that's wondrously clear, I rise. Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave, I am the dream of the hope and the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise. Beloved, it is time for you to rise. It is time for us to rise. May it be so. We don't traditionally stand for our middle hymn, but I'm going to invite you to rise in body or spirit for this one. You may or may not know this hymn. It comes from our green book, so don't look for it in your hymnals. It's one of those praise and worship hymns from the early 2000s. And so if you know it, join in. If you feel comfortable with it, join in. If you don't, I invite you to clap your hands with joy. Try that one again sometime. Beloved, it's our gift and our privilege to share our prayers with one another, not just with God, but to share our prayers in a community of love and support that can lift us, amplify our voices, and surround us with comfort. And so I invite your prayers for the church, for yourselves, for your community, for God's world, the things that bring you joy and the things that grieve your heart. I invite you to share them with one another. And after you've finished speaking, you may say, Lord, in your mercy, and we'll respond, hear our prayer. I'll ask first those of you who are in the room and then those of you who are online with us, for what and for whom is your heart praying today? Oh, beloved, whether you have spoken a prayer out loud or whether it is quiet in your heart, we know that God hears it. And so I invite you to gather all of these prayers together as we join in the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Beloved, trusting that God is doing a new thing even now and even in this place, I invite your offerings to the church and to the work of this community of God's people. If you're with us in the sanctuary and you've brought a physical gift, you can leave it in the box on the table as you leave the space today. If you're with us online or you prefer to make your gift that way, you can do so by visiting our website. I invite your gifts with generosity. And now will you rise in spirit or in body as we sing our thanks to God? Please be seated. I want to offer special thanks to those of you who helped to lead worship last week when both Bob and I were out. Bob had a much needed vacation Sunday, much deserved vacation Sunday, and so we are thankful that Maria stepped in as a musician last week. And thanks to Abby and to Drew and to Reverend Paul, who was here last week as I celebrated my ordination with my family. We will celebrate that momentous occasion on July 14th as a congregation. I think after worship, but stay tuned for what the Staff Parish Relations Committee will tell you about that. Tune into your email update, and I hope you join us on that day. Our Sunday school has been taking a summer vacation, and they'll continue to be on vacation next Sunday. So typically Sunday school is first and third Sundays. We'll skip next week in observance of the July 4th holiday this week because a lot of our families will be out of town, but we'll be back on the 21st of July for Sunday school again. We are always in need of volunteers. I want to highlight especially that we have a couple of folks who have been tech volunteers for us who will not be worshiping with us regularly, at least in the coming years. So we celebrate that Margaret, who preached with us a couple of weeks ago, will be starting doctoral work down in Atlanta, and so she is, unfortunately for us, moving away. And Abby has an internship next year, and so at least for the next year, she won't be with us every Sunday. And so if it's on your heart to volunteer in this capacity that Kimmy is doing for us today, I invite you to talk to, you can talk to me or Kimmy or Stephen or Adam has been our tech person before, to just talk about what that role is like and to see whether you might be a good fit for that role. We also have spaces for folks to volunteer as ushers, which mostly involves lighting candles, handing out bulletins, and taking attendance at church. There are spaces for readers to volunteer, lots of opportunities for you to participate in worship and shape the life of this community. Are there any other announcements? Anything else I've missed? All right, friends, then I invite you to rise in spirit or in body. If you'd like to look at the music for this hymn, I know I didn't put it in the bulletin, but it's number 725 in the red hymnal, if you'd like to look at it. Let's rise and sing. And now, beloved, go in peace, arisen in new life, new body, and new hope, blessed by the God who has known you since before you were born, blessed by Jesus, the Christ, our Redeemer and our friend, blessed by the Holy Spirit who sets your heart on fire. Now and always, go in peace. Thank you.